All right. Thanks for tuning in to the Sheet Metal Shaping Podcast, where we discuss traditional coach building techniques. And on the show today, we have Mike Wagner of Cornfield Customs. My man, what's going on?
How's it going?
It's going really good. First episode of the Sheet Metal Shaping Podcast. Thanks for being guest number one.
Oh, no problem, man.
Tell the folks a little bit about yourself.
As said, my name's Mike Wagner, and I own Cornfield Customs in Milford, Ohio, which is just outside of Cincinnati. I do a lot of different things. My main focus is sheet metal shaping, coach building, but then I also do a lot of tube chassis work, round tube bending, mandrel bending on 2x4, land speed race cars, and just kind of one-off custom vehicle design, aircraft parts. So pretty much anything around metal I'm involved with.
I love it. I saw some of your YouTube videos on bending the 2x4. You've got a pretty legit machine to bend that stuff. That's heavy
duty. Oh, yeah. I mean, it takes a big machine and a lot of power to bend 2x4 without kinking it and wrinkling it.
That's awesome. New to the industry. Explain what that actually is.
Sorry, you cut out there for a second.
For anybody who doesn't know what sheet metal shaping is, or they're new to the industry, explain what sheet metal shaping is and why that's important.
So if you kind of break down what sheet metal shaping is, all we're doing is we're manipulating a flat sheet by either shrinking it or stretching it to create different compound shapes and reverse shapes, which are essentially bending light. So a good comparison is like the new Cybertrucks. There's not much shaping involved with those because it's just all folding and bending. You know, there's not a lot of complexity to it. And a very shapely car that has a lot of shrinking and stretching is like a 65 Ferrari GTO, or, you know, an Aston Martin, where they're very voluptuous and curvy and the light just goes all over the place. So essentially we're just thickening and thinning the metal to make it shrink and stretch. And we're manipulating the light to be appealing to the eyes and give the desired shape and effect that you want in a body panel.
Where do you think the industry has come from to bring us to the current point that we're at today? Like, what is the history here?
Originally, you know, like a coach builder, it's exactly what it sounds like. You were building stage coaches, and then, you know, stage coaches turned into horseless carriages, and it kind of evolved. The biggest thing that I've noticed, especially like I've been in the industry almost 20 years, is just the level of quality and finish has changed astronomically. Like, we've always had a handful of guys that have done really high-end quality work, but now that seems to be changing to where it's not just a small handful. There's a lot of people out there putting out really high-quality work, and I think that's kind of where we're migrating to is, you know, instead of just being super niche, we're going to kind of evolve into not as small groups of high-quality sheet metal workers. So it's... the processes have changed a little bit. You know, we've had power hammers since the early 1900s, but the ease of getting them, learning how to use them, the community working together, and we're all just pushing to grow our quality in the finished product.
For sure. We'll talk tools in a little bit here, because I'm curious. I know you got a really good setup in your shop.
Yes.
Do you think that we're actually running out of restorable cars out there, like good quality starting points?
No, not really. It depends on where you look. So the big thing with that is it's kind of even hard to describe. If you're looking like behind people's garages, yes, those are running low. But if you go to the collector and the historian and the vintage race car collector, we're never going to run out, because what those guys do is, we'll just say like the vintage race car collector and restorer, a lot of those guys still race those cars. So they're out racing, they get us, you know, into a slide and they hit a wall, there's work. And then now it's even going back to where you find a section of a car and you're like, hey, I've got part of this car, let's build the rest of it so I own it. I don't really see us ever running out of restorable cars or collectibles. It's just gonna get harder and harder, and there's gonna need more skill involved to get them where you want them to be. Because, yeah, you know, as time goes on, they get worse and worse, and you're just going to need to have more skill to bring it back to life.
Do you find there's more people right now undoing what people have done 20, 30, 40 years ago, or do you still find the barn finds every now and again? They still pop up?
I'd say a little bit of both. A lot of times what I do, especially in my shop, and it's kind of funny, but not funny. I tell everybody my shop is the land of misfit toys. So pretty much every car in my shop right now, I think except for one, was pulled out of another shop to be brought to me to be fixed. And that's, it's good because it keeps me busy, but it's bad because then you have to manage the client to be like, hey, you spent six figures to have this car done and the work is so terrible, we're just going to have to throw it away and start over. And that's a really tough conversation to have. Because I mean, if I threw away $500, I'd be upset. I can't even imagine the feeling of, you know, being $100,000, $200,000, $300,000 into a car and it just being trash. So it's a lot of shops are out there fixing stuff that was done. And it's, I wouldn't necessarily say it's even from the fact that it's an older repair. It's just people didn't know any better and these cars weren't worth much back then. So they just caved it and paved it and moved on with their life. And who cares? It's just an old car. And yeah, Now people do care.
Yeah. Let's talk about the economics of actually running a shop. So obviously you're running a real business here. This is a real deal. When people bring a car into you and you tell them, hey, this is what it's going to cost, what is the typical price tag on a full-on restoration coach built vehicle?
Again, that's a really tough question because especially here, I don't give any pricing because you don't know. Like you could bring me a car that you say is, it just needs the doors fit and a hood skin made. Okay, that sounds good on paper and you sent me pictures, but then once I dig in, everything else could suck. I mean, I've ran into that before. You know, it come in for $5,000 worth of damage and it ends up being $300,000 just because you don't know what you're going to get into when you dig in. So a realistic price point, and I just try to tell people that this isn't what it's going to cost, because when you give out numbers, say you come to me and say, hey, I want a car built. And I'm like, it's going to be in between $50,000 and $100,000. You're instantly going to stick to the $50,000 side. That's just human nature. So what I try to tell people so I don't get into that situation of you told me this much money, I say, if you're not financially and mentally prepared to spend $100,000 on this project, this isn't the project or the place for you. And that's, I scale that. Like if I know it's going to be over $100,000 easily, I move it up. If you're not prepared, $200,000, $300,000. And I just kind of, I over exaggerate to where they're like, okay, I'm not prepared to spend that. Then it's it's an awakening. But if they're like, I'm prepared to spend $200,000, and I come in at 90, I'm the hero.
You're the man.
They have to be financially and mentally prepared to spend that kind of money.
Some of these cars that you see that go to SEMA, and they're like the biggest and the best. They win the Grand National Roadster Show and all these big time awards. Like these are multi-million dollar vehicles. Some of them, no?
Oh yes, yeah. I mean, I've worked on a handful of them over the years. Like not necessarily at my facility. A lot of these really big budget cars aren't really my thing. Like I don't like the stress involved with that. So like everything I build here, I think I try to keep it under $250,000, but I'm also not doing plumbing, wiring, you know, engine rebuilds, interior paint. I usually send that stuff out and have the client handle it. That way it's just one less thing I have to worry about and I can't be blamed if the painter screws up. Kind of with what we were talking about with, you know, these big money projects I've worked on all over the country, and some of the numbers, I mean, unbelievable, you know, $10-15 million dollars in a car. And looking at it, if you know what you're looking for, you can see it. But most people are like, oh man, I bet that's an $80,000 car. And it's like, yeah, you need to add like five more zeros to the back of that.
Yeah.
And you'll be kind of close.
If you're going to coach build a vehicle right from scratch, let's say you do the wire form and you know, you're doing it based on pictures or what have you. If somebody says, Mike, I want you to build me a body. I want it to look like this, you know, this vintage Aston Martin or this vintage Ferrari or this old Porsche or something like that. Right. How many hours do you think it would take to get from raw idea to wire form to, you know, completed skin, and the body's ready to be dropped on a chassis?
Depending on the design overall, you're probably looking in the 2,000 to 6,000 hour range. And that would be depending on how correct you want it. So like if I send it out to a designer, like say in Detroit, and they do a 3D rendering and we can segment a buck off of that, it's going to save a lot of time. Or if you're like, I have these two black and white pictures of this vintage car I want, and I want it built traditional, no 3D models, any of that stuff, you know, you want the traditional experience, it's going to take a lot longer, because you're going to have a few hundred hours just in historical research, talking to the right people and trying to track down the history on it. So there's a lot of, gray area in being able to predict what that's going to be. But like prime example, my Model T Roadster that we're getting ready to take to Bonneville, I had over 3,000 hours in that, and that's a Model T with a fiberglass body, you know, so it gets very, very time consuming.
Wow. And then in terms of something like that, like you see some of the stuff being put out, you know, in California, these guys are scratch building bodies. These guys are, you know, and they're being shipped all over the world. There's stuff in Australia, there's stuff in the state, like it's everywhere. I mean, is there high competition for something like this? What is happening in the market today with scratch built, coach built proper bodies?
The word competition is kind of, I would say tainted or a negative thing. Like a lot of the big guys like Luke Delay and Bespoke in Australia, like we are all in this together, and there's such a small amount of us. There might be 100 guys in the world that are doing that. And not that I know all 100 of them, but you know, I know Adrian at Bespoke. Adrian might know so-and-so. We're all in this together. So we don't really compete like a cutthroat kind of thing. I look at it, it's more like friendly competition. Like I use Adrian and Luke Delay and Kyle Yoakum and Mike Phillips and everybody that's doing it. I look up to them as like, wow, they're pushing the bar. I need to push the bar. And, you know, not in a negative way to be like, oh, that guy sucks. I could do that way better and try to stake the job. You know, we're all in this together. If any of those guys needed anything that I could offer, just call me and I will help you any way I can with experience, or if you need a helping hand. So there's so much work out there that there's no need for us to, you know, compete with one another and try to get all the jobs. I mean, currently I'm 36 months out. Like you could open up a coach building shop right next door to me and you're not going to affect my bottom line. And if you do, that's on me. That's not on you. I'm doing something wrong. And, you know, you would be successful on your own. And then I could send you all the stuff that people call about if you have openings. You know, there's such a demand for handmade bodies, handmade components, whatever you want to call it, that there's just not enough of us to go around and do all the work.
Yeah, that's cool. Collaboration over competition.
Exactly.
You hear this floating around. I think it's so true. I mean, really, at the end of the day, like nobody's trying to beat the other guy up, because this is handcrafted craftsmanship. People are coming to you guys for these types of skills. And it's great that you can either pass off or bounce off or, you know, relay ideas. That's a really cool way to look at it.
Yeah. And it's just so simple. Like, why would you want to make everybody else mad at you? There's a guy in the States. I won't bring his name up, but if a lot of metal shapers are watching this, they know who he is. And he just badmouths everybody. He's the best there ever is. You know, he won't tell anybody his pedigree of where he learned all this stuff. His work is not where it should be for his attitude. And great. Give him 5 years and he's going to burn every bridge in the industry and nobody is going to help him. You know, when he screws up the wrong deal and he needs dug out of that hole, he's on his own. Because, I mean, speaking for myself, like he could call me today and be like, man, I was doing this car for the mob and they're going to kill me unless I get this car done. I'm like, man, that sucks. You know, it's not my problem, dude. Because just the attitude he has towards, in my eyes, some of the greatest coach builders in the world. And he just talks down to them like they're peons.
Yeah. Somebody said to me one time, they said, when you're good, you tell people. When you're great, people tell you. And I think that that's just so true with this industry in specific, because you can have the biggest ego, but I mean, you can get clobbered when something goes wrong. And alternatively, if you just stay humble and keep it cool, you know, people respect you for that.
Yeah. And it's a little off topic, but like me and my wife talk about it all the time is people see that, like if you're like me, I don't think I'm anything special. I'm just a guy. But people take that the wrong way. It's like he's so arrogant, he's pretending to be humble. And then you just get in this really weird area of like, oh, he's humble bragging or he's so full of himself. But it's, you just have to be down to earth. Like anybody can do what we do. It's just a series of acquired skills and, you know, practice. So we're not any better than anybody else. We're just at different stages in our career and our skill set. And I mean, that's kind of weird, you know, dealing with that. It's a very delicate line that to where if you're like, oh, thanks, man, I really appreciate that, but it's nothing special. You're being humble but arrogant. Or you're like, yeah, that was really tough. I struggled with that and it came out killer. Well, then you're arrogant. And you should be more humble. It's a very weird area to be in.
Well, let's talk about skill acquisition. You mentioned acquiring skills. So when somebody's just a beginner, where would you recommend that they start and maybe how you started as well?
The best thing I can tell anybody is starting out, just get out there and do it. Whether you're 10 years old, 100 years old, you have a lean-to on the back of your house with a dirt floor, or you've got the best shop in the world, just get out there and do it. The way I try to tell people is it's like a doctor. You know, they go to college for 10 years, and when they graduate medical school, they're not a doctor. They have to practice. You know, you can learn everything the book tells you, everything that anybody in the world has to offer as far as advice and tips and tricks. But until you put those into practice and screw some stuff up, you're not going to learn. So just get out there and do it. I really like that mentality because I didn't have any formal education. I went to vocational school for welding and machining when I was in high school. I graduated. I worked in a body shop 6 months, and then I was a production welder for 6 months, and then I opened up the shop full time when I was 20 years old. Other than that, I have no real experience, and it was just screwing up a lot of stuff and seeing, man, this could be so much better, but I don't know how to get there. And looking at other stuff, and I mean, in magazines and forums at the time, and like, maybe I'll reach out to this guy and just be like, hey, do you have any pointers? And it's the same thing. Just get out there and do it. You just have to screw up metal and be like, oh, that was definitely not the way to proceed. And you'll learn for the next time. So sure. just get out there. And like, I get one of the questions I get all the time is like, how did you grow your skill set in your business so fast? And it's like, I do 110% today. Like I do the absolute best and I try to push to be a little bit better today. And then tomorrow when I come in, I'm going to do that little bit more to push even farther. It's an exponential growth aspect. You know, when you're just sitting around, you're like, good enough. You're going to stay at that stagnant, good enough level. But if you're always trying to push that little bit harder, you're going to just grow so much faster because like in a five day work week, if you push 10% harder every day, that's 50% growth at the end of the week. You know, you just keep growing that exponentially.
Who did you learn from as you came through to get into this trade?
Pretty much nobody. Like when I started, like I said, I have no formal education in coach building or metal shaping or running any of the machines I've got. What it was, I think a lot of it was luck and determination. I used to be a lot more extroverted than I am now. And like, I would just reach out to people like Luke DeLay. I followed him online. And when I was out in California once, I just reached out and says, hey man, I'd love to meet you and check out your facility. And you know, he let me stop by. And same thing with Kyle Yoakum. We were doing metal shaping classes with Bailey Industrial and we became friends and it just bounced ideas off each other. And hey, I know you made a part similar to this. I'm struggling here. What did you do to overcome that? And it's more of a peer education, you know, learning as I went and then struggling in an area and asking for advice versus, you know, reading out of a textbook or having an apprenticeship under somebody or, you know, any kind of formal tutelage.
Yeah. Are there any bad habits that you've seen other people pick up as they self-teach themselves and going through the industry? Any bad habits that you're like, no, I'm not going to do that, or some that you did pick up and you're like, cool, I have to let this one go?
Some of that I would have to really think on. There's always going to be bad habits. And like the first one I would say was MIG welding sheet metal. you know, not having an education in it. I'm just like, welding's welding. It doesn't make a difference. It makes a huge difference. So that was like the first one, like when I got rid of MIG welding and switched all to TIG, it changed everything. So now like I open myself up to try new things. I see people online all the time, like, this is the way you have to do it. And I'm like, I don't really think so, but I'm gonna try it. And I try it, and if it works, awesome. If not, somebody's just blowing smoke or trying to make things appear that they're not. But you always have to be willing to open yourself up to that and be like, maybe there is a better way. And I really think that that's a good thing to have. And as far as bad habits, I don't think anything is necessarily bad. It's just a stepping stone in your education. You know, you make that mistake and then you're like, that's not the way it needs to be. And you just have to be willing to move beyond that and not get stuck in those habits.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Learning from your mistakes, for sure.
Exactly. I mean, that's all we do is I've ruined tons of sheet metal. And if I'm not learning from it, I'm destined to repeat the same mistake over and over again. So you want that exponential growth and skill set. You have to be willing to learn from your mistake and try it a different way.
So if we want something practical, something that somebody could take from the show and that's just starting out, you know, would you recommend they start out with hand tools, with power tools, with reading a book? What would be the first thing for you to tell somebody, this is where you should go?
I would say start with hand tools no matter what. When I do classes, we do everything the hard way. So we start out stump shrinking with a hammer, a stump, and a piece of metal. We stretch with an anvil and a body hammer. Because if you know how to do things the hard way, you're going to understand the basic principles of why the metal moves the way it does. And then from there, when you get into power tools, it just is second nature. Like, I already know what's going to happen for the most part. I know this is going to do this. This is going to do that. And it's just an extension from your hand tool to a piece of power equipment. And it's going to move your efficiency up. But for somebody that has no experience whatsoever, I would just say, get you some sheet metal, go out, and just try different things with a body hammer or a ball peen hammer. You know, smack it different ways, try to fold it different ways. If you want to read on stuff, get you some information on radial stretch, linear stretch, and shrinking of sheet metal. Those are the three concepts in shaping. So if you can understand the basic concepts of why that's doing what it's doing, anything else can be made. It's just how you arrange those movements and those processes to get the desired shape.
Very cool. Very cool. In terms of process of a panel, let's talk about that. So when you're looking at a panel, let's say we're using a 1930s fender, for example, 1930s front fender, you know, fairly bulbous, lots of contours. You got the reverse curves, high crown, low, it's all in there. Where would you start to say, okay, I'm going to build this fender. This is step one. Where do you start and how do you proceed through that procedure?
So what, just to preface this a little bit, do we have one and we're just going to mirror it to the other side or do we have absolutely nothing?
Oh, good point. So let's say we have one, we've got the left side of the car and we have to make the right.
So what I would do is I would make a paper pattern of the existing fender that we have. And I would just look at how the paper lays to get, you know, basically our shape. So paper patterns is a very deep topic. But you'll be able to see things like coming up. We'll just say the wheel side is here and it's going to come up like this. When we lay that paper over the top of that, if we have a shrink that's being indicated and it's 14 inches long and 4 inches tall, that is a lot of shrink. So, you know, in that area, you're going to segment that fender somewhere. So I would paper pattern everything and just see what I could do that would be manageable within my skill set. And that's also kind of a gray area. Because if you want to push yourself, you have to step outside of what you feel is manageable. A lot of times I will try to make parts in one piece just to see if it's possible. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't, but then it's the learning thing. You know, like, okay, you know, 6 foot by 4 foot is too big. You know, it's you just kind of have to learn what you're physically able to hold and manipulate and how far you can shrink and how far you can stretch before the material just won't react anymore. So laying all of that out with paper patterns and kind of getting your roadmap for success laid out, and then just break that down into manageable pieces. Like if you're a guy that's like, hey, I don't know enough about shaping work, but I could make this fender and 46 inch by 6 inch pieces, awesome. You know, it's just going to take you longer to weld it and finish it. So if you can do it in three pieces, great. You know, it's going to be a trade-off of, well, that's less welding and finishing, but it's more labor holding and supporting these larger pieces and working them as one unit.
Mm-hmm. Do you prefer to do more metal finishing, or do you prefer to do less?
I prefer to do less. I really struggle with it. And mainly I think that's because I have ADHD. So it's very hard for me to hyper-focus on metal finishing and stay on task. Things around here, I tell people, I try to take things to the 90 to 95% metal finish zone. So that last 5% is going to be 95% of the work done to that point. So like if I can get it, few coats of high build primer, a little spot putty here and there, that's okay. Cause I can guarantee you, you're going to take it to the body shop. They're going to grind it with 36 grit and they're going to put a half inch of filler on it and block it straight. And what's left is left. Yeah. It's just how it works. So unless somebody has to have a perfectly metal finished car, that's going to be polished, that last 5% isn't worth the squeeze. You know, it's just so much more time and so much more money when it's not going to matter out the back end anyway.
Yeah. If you're working to a buck, how close do you get that panel to the buck or the wire form?
That also depends on the buck. So I don't know if this is the right way or the wrong way, but it's the way I do it. So if I have it and it's sitting on the buck and it's touching the majority of the stations, mm-hmm. but the flow looks right to me, that's good. There's no sense in sweating over, like, you know, buck or station four touches, five doesn't, and six does, but the flow is right. Mm-hmm. Who's going to notice? Because if it's that subtle, it's only a 32nd or a 16th. And I kind of base things on, like, look at Ferraris. You know, early Ferraris are some of the most expensive cars in the world. They could be up to 2 inches different side to side.
2 inches. Yeah.
You know, it's a coach built car. It's handmade. If you want perfect, get even a stamped car is not going to be, but you're going to pay so much more money for something that is flawless and it's still going to have flaws. It's just, again, the juice isn't worth the squeeze to that. So it's more about visual to me. Like you can make something match the buck, and who's to say the buck's not wrong or the drawings you're basing it off of are inaccurate. If it looks right on the car, to me, that's correct. And if you're doing something like that, so say you're doing a 65 Ferrari GTO, you know, one of the most iconic cars ever, and you take it to a car show and somebody's like, that quarter has the wrong radius on it. Prove it right. Yeah. You know, show me the one that you built and we'll compare notes. And that's really what it is it's, you know, every car is completely different. Like even cars that come off the factory line today, they're all going to be a little bit different. Just tooling wears, things slip in fixtures, you know, it's just going to be a little bit different. So nothing is perfect out the door. Yeah. And that's where a little bit of refinement comes in. And
for sure,
you have to be willing to sacrifice perfection for acceptance.
Yes. Yes. Going back to the 1930s fender. So if you were to build something like that from a paper pattern and so on, how long do you think that would take you to do it, having the skills that you currently have now?
We'll just say it's a Model A fender, just so have a more descriptive. So a Model A front fender to be bolt on, wire edged, all the flanges turned, everything, you'd probably have about 80 to 100 hours in it. It might be less, it might be more. Say you wanted to do a rear fender, I could knock out in about 40, 45 hours, but you're going to get that extra challenge where it comes up over and then you get that long sweeping reverse. That reverse is going to eat some time. The panel is going to be bigger. You're going to have more wire edging to do. It just gets compounded, and that, you know, more flanging to turn up against a firewall in the hood side. But I would say that that's relatively close.
Mm-hmm. And if you were going to price that, how would a shop like yours, you know, again, knowing what you know, how would you price a Model A fender? And let's, obviously you can buy a Model A fender, so that's probably not the one to build, because you could buy it for way cheaper, right? But like for a car that you just can't have, like for something that just doesn't exist out there, or there's no, you know, there's only one fender in the whole world and you have to build the second one, what would that cost?
Again, I don't really give pricing. If it was something I've built thousands of, I would still give a ballpark. So, you know, I mean, we'll just say, I can't remember what I just said, you know, hours wise, let's say it's what, 100 hours? Is that what I said on the front fender?
80 to 100, yeah.
Yeah, so $8,000 to $10,000 at $100 an hour. Yeah. And that's the thing, is that worth it for a Model A fender? No. But, I mean, I've done some 1909 Oldsmobile fenders. I mean, they were some of the most challenging fenders I've ever done. Where are you going to get them? They looked for years. You know, I did the Zagato quarter panel. Where are you going to call and order a polished aluminum 61 Aston Martin Zagato quarter panel? You're not. I did a Lotus Series 1 drop nose. It was all smashed up. Where are you going to get that? So it's good and bad, because it allows you to not really demand your price, because you don't want to be, you know, ripping people off. But if they can't find it anywhere, they're kind of out of options. And the best thing I do is I'm super transparent about it. You know, I send them detailed work notes. This is where the time went. This is what I did. This is a breakdown of why it cost what it cost.
Mm-hmm, for sure. In terms of breaking that panel up, so using, we'll just stick on the Model A fender because it's easy. Yep. In terms of breaking that panel up, when you look at a panel and you say, okay, I like to do bigger pieces with less metal finishing. Some people like to do the opposite. Where would you break a panel up like that to be most efficient with your wheeling or your hammering or however you prefer to make it?
Just off the top of my head, I would break it down into three pieces. So if you're looking at it from the front, I would probably break it down the center of the high crown. And then where the reverse starts, I would move up maybe 4 or 5 inches approximately. And I would segment that horizontally. So I would do the long reverse flat in one piece. And then I would do the top front part in two halves, just almost right in the center of the compound shape at the top.
Gotcha. Does that hold true for something low crown, like a roof skin, for example? Would you break it up into multiples, or would you just go one big piece?
That also depends on the roof skin. So like a Model A coupe, 32 coupe, 33, any of that stuff that I can physically manhandle the panel by myself, you can do it in one piece. They end up being, you know, like a Model A coupe is a little over 48 inches by 48 inches. So that's a big piece, especially in steel if you're working it alone. But if you're doing, say, a Model A sedan, it's going to be twice that much. I have done one in one piece. I had a buddy help me, and it was about an 8-hour situation on a power hammer, and it was miserable. So when I do one that large, I split it right in the middle, work the two halves, weld it up, and then we power hammer the weld seam, raise everything up, and blend it out.
Yeah. You mentioned power hammer a couple times. Do you prefer the hammer over the wheel, or do you mix and match?
I am extremely power hammer heavy. I do have a wheeling machine, but the rubber upper wheel stays in it 99% of the time. I've just found, being a one-man shop, that it's so much more efficient for me to focus on the hammer, and it fits my personality and the way my brain works so much better. And I can just kind of rock and roll and knock stuff out.
Yeah. Okay. Well, let's talk tools. So break down the types of tools that you have in your shop and maybe what your preference is and why.
So metal shaping wise, I have some Bailey equipment. I have an MH19, an MH37 HD, and then I have an original 1909 Pettingill number one power hammer. So I use those the majority of the time. The MH37 power hammer is similar to like a K90 Yoder, but it's new and Bailey makes it. It's large. It can move some material. It can do some damage. That's my main go-to, just because it hits hard. It's easy to adjust. I've got tooling for it, so I can just get in there, get it set up, rough out what I need to do. And then from there, after power hammer stuff, I've got an original Milwaukee air planisher. I love that thing. I mean, that's my go-to planisher. I've got a CP and a Bailey planisher, but man, that Milwaukee, it just, it leaves a killer finish. I've got a bead roller, a Lennox for doing body line profiles and edge turning, kick shrinkers. I mean, I've got I've got all kinds of tools, and that's just the metal shaping side. So it's, we could be here all day talking about tooling in the shop.
Anyway, why do you prefer the hammer over the wheel in terms of technique and finish and things like this? Like, what is it about it that does it for you?
For me, it's just the way that the hammer works. I've always struggled with wheeling stuff. So when I started out, all I had was a wheel. I could get by, but I would always get stuck with like that last little bit, because a wheel works in a linear motion and it's all based on tension. So if you get some weird tension built up in the panel and you can't get it out, it's just going to make things worse. So with a hammer, they work in more of a relaxed state. So by the time you do all your initial thumbnail shrinking, it's a little tight. And then when you blend and planish everything out, it kind of relaxes it. So then you can take the panel and you can completely change the arrangement and change the form and manipulate it to do what you need to do. And then at the end, you can just put the form back in it and it fits. You try to do that with a wheeled panel where that tension's built up in there, you know, you're going to get that form trapped into the shape as you continue shaping the panel. And that's just the difference between like a linear tension-based shaping versus shrinking or radial stretch or linear stretch on a power hammer. It's just more of a relaxed state. So I can interpret that better, and I can predict easier how the metal is going to react to that instance. So I think if it was more like I worked more on the wheel, that would be more predictable for me. But there was just something the first time I saw a power hammer being operated, like my eyes got real big and I'm like, man, this is what I need in my life. You know, it's loud, it's exciting. And I was hooked at that point. So, and that's kind of where I branched off, and it just works for me. And that's kind of a good point to talk about is, if you're a wheel guy and that works for you, that's awesome. If you're a wheel guy and you're struggling, try a power hammer. If it makes sense, awesome. If it doesn't, stick to the wheel. You know, don't be afraid to get out there and try things that are different. There's different ways for different reasons. So just find the one that works best for you and take all this little information and, you know, kind of store it away of, maybe I can use this little bit and this little bit and this little bit and bring it into how I work.
Yeah. There's always such a divide between the hammer guys and the wheel guys. I find
you gotta have
the hammer, and some guys, you can only use the wheel. And it's just like, it's this clear divide. Why do you think that's been built up in the industry for so long? This is like Coke and Pepsi.
I think a lot of it comes back to the separation of Europe versus the United States. You know, excuse me. Wheeling stuff is traditional, and this is how we do it in England and France and in Italy. This is how the traditional cars were built. And then, you know, we came out with power hammers in the early 1900s. All those stupid Yanks over there, they're just making noise and it's loud and it's aggressive and, you know, whatever. It's just, I think that's what it is just the societal differences and how people build that up in their mind. And it's funny, if you pay close attention to a lot of the guys either way that are, we'll just say wheel, you can only wheel a panel. That's the only way to do it. And they teach classes on it. Well, now they're going into, well, I'm making a power hammer too, because they realize they can profit from that. So, you know, they act like this is the only way to do it until they dive into that rabbit hole and like, hey, it isn't so bad. There are instances where this works. And when I do classes, I do the same thing. I said, look, try it both ways and see what works for you. And a lot of it will come down to the kind of shop you have. Like if you're a home guy in a subdivision, are you going to have a Yoder sitting on your back porch? No, your neighbors are going to kill you. But you could have a wheeling machine sitting in your living room and nobody's ever going to know. So you have to kind of play to your audience and play to your atmosphere and just work with what you've got. And, you know, I've had guys here that the wheel is the only way, that's the only true path. And then I let them use the hammer. Man, that's pretty cool. I see why you like that. It's just what you're exposed to and what you have at your disposal.
Very cool. Let's wrap this up with the importance of good design. So you can build something, you can bang sheet metal, you can do all this, you can have the best skills, but if the car is ugly at the end of the day, the car is ugly. So what is the importance of design and why do you think that matters in your craft?
It's kind of a loaded question because I really don't care. Like, yeah. What I think is appealing might not be to you. You know, it's all in the eye of the beholder. So who am I really to pass judgment on that? And it does go to a point where you can be like, no, this is really bad. You should not be doing that. But it's one of those things they won't know until you show them. For me, design is important under multiple things. Like, you know, I'm very heavy into land speed racing. So design in that aspect, you know, it could be ugly, but is it aerodynamic? And that's kind of where, you know, like I'm really kind of weird because it has to be both. There's a certain type of land speed car that I admire because they're fast, but aesthetically they do nothing for me other than going fast. And like, I would rather have a little bit of design in there and pay homage to, you know, traditional built land speed cars and sacrifice a little bit of that aerodynamic advantage. So that's going to come back to personal taste again, like to each their own. And I mean, we had a Pacer, we had a Gremlin, you know, we had all these really ugly cars that people love. And it just, I don't know, like it's important, but it's not important. It's only important for the person that's paying the bill to have it made. So I don't know if that's a really good answer or not, but I think
You know what, it's great. And one thing as we wrap up here that I really appreciated about this episode is your genuineness and your openness and your honesty towards the industry and your opinion. The fact that you've mentioned a couple of times now, like it's not what's right or wrong, it's just what's right or wrong for you, really shows through to your character and the fact that, you know what, lots of people, different strokes for different folks. And, you know, if I take anything from this episode, it's going to be that. It's just be genuine, be honest, be open, and you can have an opinion and so can everybody else. And that's right. And that's okay.
Yeah, because there's no reason to divide us any more than society already is, you know, with white collar workers versus blue collar workers and creative types and non-creative types. And it's just, we all need to work together and coexist together because we all have different strengths. There was this big stink a few years ago. It was when Jesse Combs was still alive. Me and her talked about it. I remember a meme came out like, tell your kids it's okay to go to trade school. Not everybody can be a doctor or a lawyer. Like that really kind of rubbed me the wrong way because that's, tell your kids it's okay to settle for not being a white collar worker. So I made a meme that was like, tell your kids it's okay to go to college. Not everybody can be a skilled artisan. And I posted that meme everywhere and I got so much hate about it, but it's the truth. Like if you're getting offended because I say it's okay to go to college, you can't be an artisan. You know, am I allowed to be offended that it's okay to go to trade school because not everybody's smart enough to be a doctor? Like, it's just different. We don't need to bullshit each other for whatever reason. Like, just like you said, be open, be honest. There's tons of different things for everybody in the world, you know, whether it be like I used to be a mini truck guy and now I'm working on some really cool European race cars and land speed cars. Do mini trucks do anything for me anymore? No. But do I rag on mini truckers? No. Because that's not my thing anymore. But if it makes them happy, it makes them happy.
Yeah, for sure. Very cool. Well, man, thanks so much for being on the show. Where can people find out more about you and what you're doing with Cornfield?
You can find me everywhere. I'm on Facebook. I'm on Instagram, YouTube, Threads. I mean, pretty much anything. You can Google me, just Google Cornfield Customs LTD. When you do that, there'll be a couple other pages that come up. Like there used to be subsets of my company. Like we had a side that was just like CNC plasma cutting. So if you see that, it was part of the business. I just don't offer those anymore, but I think the pages are still active. But the main thing is just Cornfield Customs LTD or Limited. Like I said, Google, YouTube. I'm really working on growing my YouTube channel and starting to do some like business advice, business ideas on stuff I've struggled with through the years to help up and coming business owners. You know, I try to give out a lot of technical advice on there as well, Facebook and Instagram. So just look me up and that's where I'm at. And then I'm all over the place going to events and stuff anyways.
Beautiful. All right. Well, thanks for tuning into the podcast today. This is Mike Wagner from Cornfield Customs. Don't forget to check us out on Instagram at sheetmetalshaping, and we will see you on the next episode.
Yeah. Thanks for having me, man.
All right, buddy.